and I just fell head over heels in love with this place. And it was full of weirdos and artists and dreamers.
That was Jillian Fitzgerald, co-owner of Casement's Bar in the Mission. I'm Jeff, and this is Storied San Francisco. In this podcast, Jillian picks up where she left off in part one. After college, she lived in the Dominican Republic for a few years before picking up and moving to San Francisco in 2005. It was love at first sight. She worked at several bars and cafes before helping to open Virgil's in the Mission. Later, she and a partner started selling Bloody Mary mix, and she helped open Westburger in the Mission. But she never lost her dream of having her own Irish bar. Jillian ends the podcast talking about opening Casements with her business partner, Sean O'Donovan, and how they've weathered the various COVID shutdowns. These days, you can order food and drink for pickup on Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays. And we encourage you to do so. See Casement's website, casementsbar.com, for more info. Here's Jillian.
And I worked in bars in college too.
You did? Okay, yeah. That's what I was gonna ask.
Yeah. I worked in a clubhouse, and I worked in a bar in my little village that, like, it's just Guinness and gin and tonics, you know.
What more do you need?
Yeah, it's a great bar. It's open today. I'm delighted. They opened back up yesterday.
Good.
Yeah, so good luck to them in Fergie's.
And did you go 4 years or like?
Yeah, I did 4 years.
Okay.
And then another bar I worked at called Caffrey's, the couple that owned it, the gentleman that owned it, was a really dear, good friend of mine and kind of like an uncle to me. He was just very, like, just a really good guy to me. And he owned a bunch of property in the Dominican Republic and Spain and some other places. And he's like, do you want to come with me? Because you're finished. You've finished school and you have this degree in construction. Like, do you want to come with me and take a look at what we're doing and see if, like, if you like it or see if... Because he wanted, you know, he wanted eyes there that he could trust. And I was like, cool, I'll go. And then...
Had you been overseas yet?
I had been overseas. Like, I've been over here and I've been...
You had?
Okay. Yeah, I've been around, but... I'll be 100% honest with you. He said Dominican Republic, and I was like, I have absolutely no idea where that is.
Yeah.
And I went home, because in my brain, I thought it was like somewhere, like a former, like, Russian, like, USSR state or something. I was like, I don't know where that is. And then I looked it up on the map on the computer, and I was like, oh, shit, it's in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
And so the next week, I got on a plane with him, and I went there, and I was supposed to go for a week. And my first stint was, I think, 3 months there. And then I was there for 4 years, so.
I've never been, but
it's stunning.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful. The people are just absolutely the nicest people. There's a lot of, because it's on the island of Hispaniola, so there's a lot of Haitian immigrants there too, who are, like, fantastic people. Yeah, it's just a great melting pot. It's a wonderful, it's obviously, it's, you know, it has its problem, like, it's there's no middle class there, which is crazy.
Okay.
It's like very wealthy people and then very poor people.
Right.
And so I spent my time between Santo Domingo and the northeast peninsula called Samaná.
Okay.
And we were building an office space in the city and then, like, luxury houses and on the northeast.
Did you speak Spanish already?
I did not. I knew how to say, can I go to the bathroom?
Sure.
Or where's the bathroom?
Yeah.
That was about it. And
I've
been to Spain a bunch when I was a kid, but, like, I had that lazy English first language thing where I was like, how come everybody doesn't speak English?
Right. Why do I gotta press
one? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And you learned, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I did.
On the spot, which is
obviously
the best way to learn any language, right?
I got thrown into it. And then in the beginning I had, like, I was working, so I went over with that man, Brendan, but then I ended up working for another group that adjacent to him. And the gentleman that owned it was, like, from Dublin, like, very wealthy guy. And so I had, like, a driver who was like, yeah, so, like, he would do all the talking for me. So, like, after a year I was just like, nah, I got it.
Let me at it.
Let me at it. So yeah. I started taking a couple of lessons, and then just, I have very like it's kind of bad because that's like very slang forward, and it's very, like my Spanish, I've had to change it a lot because people don't know what I'm talking about, because it's like Cuban, Dominican, regional, and Puerto Rican Spanish is like very like, they don't finish words, they don't.
Yeah.
So I get a lot of
that's like island.
Island people, that's what we do. We're just like, ah.
Yeah.
So
you know what I'm saying. Yeah. Why do I gotta finish the word?
Finish the word. But it was
4 years.
Yeah, it was an incredible, like, I tell people about, I was telling someone about it last night, and I was just like, it was an insane, like, I'd go to work at like 7 o'clock in the morning in like this office building on a Wednesday, and a helicopter would come and pick me and my boss up because he didn't like this.
You did helicopter rides to work?
It was crazy. Oh my God. Land on a beach.
Jesus Christ.
And then we'd go have lunch and then go look at what he wanted to look at and then get back on the helicopter and be back.
Just absolutely horrible.
It was crazy. And then we only did that because he wouldn't fly in the little planes, but the little planes were the little four seaters. And my nickname was, I did have a nickname, it was Sleepy.
Sleepy.
Because I would get on these little four-seater planes, I'd sit with the pilot in the co-pilot seat and pass out.
Yeah.
Because the heat, with the sun hitting you.
Yeah.
I would get 10 minutes into the flight and I'd be like, I don't think I ever stayed awake for the whole thing.
So I'm going to just guess on some math. So that was after college and about 4 more years. So, but I also heard you say that the idea for this place was about 10 years ago.
Yeah.
So that must have come roughly next.
Yeah,
right?
I landed in the DR when I was 21.
Right, out of,
and then I
out
left
college.
When I was 23 or 24.
Okay.
And then came straight here.
Okay.
So I've been here 13 years. So I left when I was, so it's 3 years, three and a bit and change in
three
the DR.
Change. Can we talk about why? What brought you here?
Oh, well.
And had you visited before you decided?
Yeah, so there's a visa program called J1, which I'm sure a lot of people listening are aware of or heard of. And Irish children take it to maximum with it. So the program sort of, you know, you go down to Fisherman's Wharf or you go down and you see all these Irish kids trying to rent you bikes or sell you oysters. And the kids from Romania and Slovenia and like South Africa are all working their asses off, saving money, and the Irish kids are just blowing it through their pockets. So I came here and I worked at a place in Fisherman's Wharf called Tiernan's, which is now this place called Starbucks.
Okay.
Starbucks, oh, yeah, Starbucks. I think it's how you pronounce
it. Yeah.
Starbucks.
Mm-hmm.
And
I've heard of it.
It's across from the Buena Vista Cafe.
Right.
And I was so cheeky. They loved me in there because they put me in the front because people would come in and be like, is this the place you get the famous Irish coffee? And I'd be like, it sure is. Come on in. So I lied to so many tourists. I'm so sorry.
Awesome. Hey, no, you gave them a good time.
We had a better one.
And
anyway,
they went home telling people, I only paid, what, $2 for
Irish coffee. Right. And
can I back up real fast though? Like, what was it about San Francisco? Like, what, you know?
Well, the reason to
could have gone
here,
anywhere.
It's so funny. When I listened to one of your podcasts the other day, I think I heard you ask somebody that, and I was trying to remember. We stopped in Chicago for a couple of days, and I think the rationale behind coming to San Francisco was, it was the furthest place away that we could get for value for money without being in Hawaii. And I think I'd seen some movies growing up, and then my grandparents had visited here, and there's a lovely picture of them that I at Golden Gate Bridge, and they came here in the 60s. They went to Mexico on a farming trip.
Nice.
I worked on our agricultural trip. And yeah, I think I'd always had it in my head. I think that James Bond movie with Grace Jones.
You Do a Kill.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then my dad is always, you know, he's big into like the older TV. I watched a lot of TV with my dad growing up. So,
okay.
Yeah, he was always the streets of San Francisco. Yep. And yeah, I just was interested in it. I remember
it
watching
just
like.
Drew you in.
Yeah, and there's this weird TV in England that like, it's like almost like porn. It's so strange. It's called Eurotrash, and it was Jean-Paul Gaultier's show. And I used to watch, like, as a teenager, watch that.
Yes.
And they would do, they did specials on like San Francisco and like the Castro and the handkerchiefs in your pocket, like explaining all that. And so I think I was just like, whoa, this is like
magical,
so different than where I'm from. I want to go to this place.
So that versus what your impression when you got there?
Oh, well, I have to say some weird stuff
I really
happened.
Love people's first.
Well, in my head, so I did that stupid thing where, and I have so many friends who come over here and I'm like, bring clothes.
I was going to say, shorts in July.
I was like, Baywatch, you know, I loved Baywatch growing up. I rewatched it recently, it's shit.
It's total
it's
shit.
It's so bad, it's just
but
boobs.
But it's California, and so that's,
yeah.
Well, boobs and, right.
It's boobs but, and bodies, but it's right. Absolute horseshit. It's not that I had that idea in my head, but when we flew over Daly City, and I was like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
And then
I
we landed
like to call
in.
Grayley City.
June. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Daly City's lovely, but
I love
know,
Daly City.
It was foggy and it was cold, and I was like, what the fuck? And then we took
and you,
BART.
And you lived in an island also.
Yeah. So. And I was like, and so we took BART. It was with my sister and a friend of ours, Orla, and we took BART and we came out at Union Square, and I'm not messing. It was so cold, and the first person that I saw, he's dead now, but was the guy that has the rat with the cat with the...
Oh, yeah.
That guy?
Yeah.
And I was like, what is this place? I love it.
Right. This is perfect.
I was just like, weird and cool. And so we stayed in a hostel for like a week, and then...
Wait, who's we?
Oh, my sister and I, and... Okay. So we came here for a summer.
Oh, got it.
Sorry. And this is my first time here.
Got it.
And we stayed in a hostel for a week.
Like off of Union Square?
Yeah, hostel? It's still there, I think. And then we were looking on Craigslist for somewhere to live, and we found this apartment next to, it's on Bay, next to like O.J. Simpson's old school, the football field.
Oh, Galileo,
Galileo, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's this like gorgeous, like absolutely gorgeous building. And I was like, oh, I'm never going to get this. And so I went in, we pretended that I was a nurse, and there was only one of me. And he was like, you're going to have to look after my cat. And I was like, ugh.
Who, the landlord said that?
We were subletting from a guy for 3 months or 4 months.
Okay.
And I was like, yeah, I'm a nurse. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Quiet as a mouse, that's me. And then this albino cat with red eyes.
Yeah.
Still haunts my dreams.
Yeah.
And we looked after this cat, and then so I lived in the most beautiful building. I can't remember how much rent was, but it was not that much.
Roughly,
between three.
Roughly 10 years ago?
This was 15 years ago,
15,
I think.
15, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And so I was talking to one of the guys last night who I worked with. So myself and Mark DeVito, who owns Standard Deviant Brewing, Odie owns Dirty Nellies, and then I'm still friends with a couple of the girls too. So it's like, and a bunch of them are from San Francisco, went to high school here, but I'm still friends with them. And like, they showed me, like, I didn't have the touristy thing. I had the like zeitgeist, and like, I even went to like bars in the marina, which,
To find out what they are.
Not for me.
Yeah. You had a dive bar crash course.
Yeah, and then went all around Polk Street, and then like was definitely in the Mission a bunch, and would go to house parties here, and so, so I had this other experience that like was much more of a local experience.
Yeah.
And I just fell head over heels in love with this place, and it was full of weirdos and artists and dreamers, and like, I think the main difference between, you know, I firmly believe San Francisco is going to bounce back from this, and it's going to. The reason so many boring people moved here is because their job was here. I moved here because I love San Francisco, and those people are here because their job is here.
Speaking of tax breaks,
yeah, and it's not. I feel sorry for them. I was like, these kids that would come, and I'd be like, you wouldn't even do well in like a two-tier city in the Midwest. Like, you want to be, like, in, like, suburbia by the time you're 23. And
right.
And you're here, and you don't want to be here, and you have no friends, and you spend all your money on rent, and everyone thinks you're rich.
I was gonna say,
nobody likes you.
If like, I can generalize, they, you know, a lot of them worked at places where they would buy all the meals for you, and it's like...
Yeah, I had a...
What's that?
You're driving up the rent, driving families and generations out, but not... I'll stop editorializing.
No,
but you know what I mean?
No, I totally... Yeah. And I really did try really hard when the... When people were sitting at the bar and I would meet these young men and I'd be like, you have to do me a favor. You stop getting your hair cut at work. You have a barber in your neighborhood. You need to know his name.
Right.
You need to get your laundry, your dry, pick up your own. Nobody's
yes.
that busy.
Yes.
Come on. Able-bodied people using Amazon
yeah.
while the bookstore, and then they give out that this place is dirty and this place, well, if...
Let's keep ordering from Amazon and it'll keep being dirty.
Yeah.
We've got a lot, but I do want to hear the story of
here?
This
okay.
place.
So
take us through. You got your apartment and...
Yeah, so Sean and I worked at a bar called Nikki's.
This Sean.
Yeah. So Sean and I worked, Sean, my business partner here, he and I worked at a bar called Nikki's in the Lower Haight, Solaire.
Yeah.
And, you know, while we were closing up the bar at nighttime or we were talking, we're very good friends, and we were talking about, like, how we could help out in Ireland and with the recession that was going on and, you know, how if we had our own bar, what would it look like? And so then it started this idea.
This is, like, 2009 or so?
Yeah. Okay. And, you know, from that, I moved away from Nikki's, and I started my own bar with Leela and Tom over at Virgil's Sea Room.
Oh, yeah.
And after a couple of years, I sold my shares there to like focus more on other projects that I was working on. I had a company with my friend Kelly, who owns McVicker Pickles, and she and I did a Bloody Mary mix called Proud Mary.
Yes.
Very delicious, spicy. And for two white girls, one from Kansas and one from Ireland, it's pretty spicy. It's crazy.
Okay.
We both like spice. And I wanted to focus more on those projects. And so I ended up helping open a couple of different bars around the city. And then my friend Wes, who owns Westburger.
Oh yeah, from Texas, like me.
Yeah.
That's why I love his burgers. I'm like, they taste like my parents' burgers.
They're just nostalgic.
They're
like,
fucking perfect.
They're perfect. They're just nostalgic. I don't like, he knows this, I don't like tots.
Okay.
And that's because it's
like
nostalgic.
You want to have fries or?
Just because you grew up eating tots, that's why you like tots.
Well, I grew up with both.
But and you know
Sprinkle,
what I mean? Like,
yes,
I,
he,
like,
yes.
Like,
yes.
I did not eat tots as a
right.
child.
Yeah.
I only, the first time I ever had them was there, and I was
right.
like, I don't like these.
They don't do anything
I was
for
like,
you.
I want french fries.
Have you had them with queso?
Yeah, no.
No?
I also
okay.
didn't grow up with queso. So
no one grew up with
that's
queso.
Texas. Yeah.
Very Texas.
When he was opening, I got to meet Chris Hastings, and Chris owns The Lookout, and we were at Trick Dog one night after, I think maybe we... He just opened Westburger. I worked with him. I was like, I'll stay for 3 months and help you open it up and get everything going. And
at Westburger.
At Westburger,
okay.
Yeah. Because I love opening places.
Yeah.
The sixth time we opened here, I decided I don't like opening places anymore.
Okay.
we'll be seven on Tuesday, by the way.
Right.
In
right,
a year.
Right.
But I explained to him, I was like, look, I have this idea. Love to like run it by you someday, and I kind of gave him the gist of it, and he was like, okay. So I took him here, and we sat. This is Gaslight Tavern.
Gaslight? Yeah,
Gaslight
yeah.
Tavern. So I took him here, and I, because he lives close by.
Right.
And Westburger's right there.
Yeah.
And then we sat in the middle of the bar, and I gave him the idea for what Sean and I had been talking about for years, and he goes, okay. He's like, let's start looking. And he goes, what do you want to feel like? And I was like, I want it to feel like this bar.
This place.
This is the bar that I want to feel like. So cut to 2 years later, we were in escrow in three different places. We looked at 12 places. We wrote business plans for 5 places.
Can you tell me the 3 that you're in escrow for to make it manageable?
No.
Just like where casements you could have been? Neighborhoods at
one
least?
In Soma.
Yeah.
One in the Lower Haight, which is an
that's,
one.
Yeah.
And then the other one was also in the Mission.
Okay.
So, okay. I think casements can work anywhere. It's okay.
Right.
But yeah. But so, we sat at Linnea, we were having a coffee, and I was
right.
working at Mission Bowling Club at the time. I did the bar program there.
Okay.
And I was on my way to work, and I met Chris and Sean, and we sat down, and I said, look, this is just like... I can't deal with this anymore. This is too much. I was like, I'm going to write the guy that owns that bar a letter, and I'm going to ask him if he'll sell it to us. And they were like, okay, do that. So I went into work, into a Mission Bowling Club, and a rep for Fort Point came in, and he overheard me talking about it. And he said, you know what I heard today? I heard they're trying to sell it. So he walked me up here, and I met the guy's name's Roger, and started talking to him, and then explained what we were trying to do. And then we made an offer eventually, and then after a lot of, you know, the usual back and forward, we got the keys. And we got the keys early November last year. 2019, we got the keys. November. We opened softly. David Marks is here. He's our interior designer, and he's also did Virgil's and also did Westburger.
Oh, there you go.
And so, you know, the morning of, there was no paint on the walls. We had no money. We decided to open softly for my birthday.
Which is?
November 20th.
Okay, 2019.
Just a couple of weeks ago, yeah.
Right. Happy belated.
It was our one-year anniversary. Thank you. And then what we did was we opened for like 4 or 5 days a week, and we did construction in the morning and tried to make some money at nighttime.
Yeah.
And by January, we were able to put the sign outside. And we opened up January, I think it was 19. I'm very, very proud of where I'm from. Yeah. And like when we started the bar, Sean and I, in the beginning, when we started talking about the idea of this 10 years ago,
wow.
The Irish economy was in a huge recession, and like it is again today for different reasons. And, you know, a big focus for us was like, well, if we can't be there, and like if we're not, how can we help? So it's like, how can we push new product and new? So like the whole concept around the bar is, okay, there's, for an example, there's Slieve Lake Distillery in County Donegal. I was like, well, I want to be the first person to carry that in America.
Right.
They can't afford to have a rep here. I'll be their rep. Like, right. I'll push it forward for them.
Yeah.
So yeah, we, all the staff here are like very well versed in whiskies and gins and emerging product and poutines, and like that's our goal. Our goal is to make sure people understand that it's not just Jameson. Like Jameson is wonderful and all, but it's not just Jameson.
There's more than that.
Yeah.
When did you first hear of the virus?
I was in Ireland. We obviously worked through the holidays and we worked through everything, and Sean and I both decided that we needed to go home. So he went home for a week, and the week of the Super Bowl, and then I went home the week after. The week before that, sorry.
A tag team kind of.
Yeah, we tagged like one day over.
Here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I was driving down to Dingle, which is in Kerry, and I was in the car with my parents, and there was a talk radio show on, and people call in. It's called Joe Duffy, and they always call in, and they're giving out, and it's old, you know, it's a great show.
Right.
But a Chinese man who lives in Ireland, who owns a Chinese restaurant, was on it, and he's like, my business is down 80% because there's this virus in China, and people think that somehow that correlates to me. The same way people think Corona beer, you know, the sales or whatever.
Yeah, all the racism that comes in.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. And so, like, he was just on the radio, and he was just like, I'm dying here. Like,
and you
I
heard
don't
this.
Know. Yeah, he's like, I don't know what to do about my business. And I was like, that is insane. I can't believe someone would, like, put those two things together.
Right.
And I was just like, that, like, and then in my head I thought, like, SARS. Like, I was like, that maybe is the height of what's going to happen with this,
right.
You know. I wasn't worried about it at all.
Yeah.
And then came back here. And then we decided St. Patrick's Day was going to be our pride. So we were like, all right, this is our pride week. So I made a full week of events. We had a drag queen coming in on Sunday to do kids' stories so they could learn about like Irish folklore. We had tastings. We had traditional Irish music. We were going to show movies. We were going to show these, like this, you know, the more the cultural side of stuff, not just the drinking side of
right.
stuff. And obviously the drinking side too, but... and so
and that's right when it happened.
Paddy's Day was the 17th, so
yeah, that's
we had
right
to
when
close
it happened.
On the 15th.
Yeah.
So we'd been open for 6 weeks.
Oh my God, please hang on to those plans.
I know.
For whenever we can, right?
Right. Oh yeah. Their calendar's ready to go. My Yves Saint Croissant is ready to tell children stories.
Okay.
And so, yeah, it was an absolute like punch to the stomach, like yes. for everybody.
Right.
I'm smiling and I'm happy because, like, there's nothing else I can do. We did nothing wrong. All we've done is work our asses off and try and push other people forward, and everybody's pushed us forward, and I've zero regrets about 2020. So
I was gonna say, here we are 9 months later and the business is obviously still, I mean, this is
the last day.
Last day we can do this, but
we were so fortunate because we didn't have procedures and practices in place. And I feel really sorry for people who have businesses for X amount of years, because it's really hard to switch, because when you've done something one way for so long, we were like, well, we don't know what we're doing.
Right.
We have to do this thing now? Fine, okay. Right. We have to do this thing now? Fine, okay. So when we heard about this, I was like, okay, like the only thing that's upsetting and has been keeping me awake and anxiety through the roof is our staff. And like,
right.
like we'll be fine. Me and Sean will be fine. Me and Chris will be fine. Like, we'll be fine. The bar will probably be fine. But I just worry about all my friends in the industry, and it's just... I don't start crying, sorry, but like it's just awful.
You spoke a little bit about your feeling that San Francisco is gonna
definitely
recover and
I'm so excited
and be
for
better
it.
If I can put words in your
yeah,
mouth.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you think about it? And you kinda touched on it, but what are your feelings and let's just say hopes for this place?
For this place?
Is that gonna be part of San Francisco coming
yes.
back?
The thing that we're trying to put across to people about an Irish bar is an Irish bar is not really about what the aesthetic. An Irish bar is more, it's a community space for your community, whatever your community is, because
right.
it doesn't matter.
Right.
Because if you go into an Irish bar in the middle of Kilmessan, where I'm from, it's the bar. It's the only bar there,
right.
more or less. Sorry, Thorns. There's another bar called Thorns. But it's the only bar there. So like, you are in a bar with an 85-year-old. You are in a bar with a 19-year-old. You are in a bar with a 35-year-old. You're all listening to the same music. You're all
right.
doing the same thing. And so after a funeral, that's where you go. When someone dies, that's where you go. You talk, like, that's, it's community. And that's what we have since the day we opened, and during all the way through COVID, when this, like, the Stud is like a, they're very dear, dear friends of ours.
Mm-hmm.
When that closed, they all come here, and a lot of their patrons come here because
yeah.
they feel comfortable here, because it's a space for everybody. And like, there could be a bunch of Irish lads sipping away on pints of Guinness in the corner, and there could be like a drag queen sitting across from them. And that literally is why I love San Francisco.
That was Jillian Fitzgerald. On the next episode of Storied San Francisco, you'll get to know Tony Karachi, current owner of Black Star Pirate Barbecue. Please join us for episode 48 next Tuesday. Music for Storied San Francisco is by Otis McDonald. Photography is by Michelle Kilfeather. The show is hosted and produced by me. Michelle and I have produced more than 140 episodes over the last 3 years, and you can find them all at our website, storiedsf.com. While you're there, please check out our store, where in the month of December, we're donating proceeds of all sales to Supply Hope Info, a new nonprofit helping students with distance learning. We're on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, where you can like, comment, and share the stuff we put out. Find our shows just about everywhere you can listen to podcasts, including most recently BFF.fm's new podcast network. Please subscribe to stay up to date on all the content we publish. We love feedback, so if you have any, our email is storiedsf@gmail.com. Thanks for listening. Stay strong, stay safe, wear a mask, and stay healthy.
This podcast is a proud member of the BFF.fm podcast network. Learn more at podcasts.bff.fm.
BFF.fm, best frequencies forever.